Hello, good evening. When I was a teenager, I hated wearing suits, dress shoes, and especially ties. But I was forced to wear such things on the occasion of weddings or other religious activities. My mom always told me that I will have to wear a suit with tie and dress shoes later in my life for getting a proper job. I never liked this idea, and I soon started to think that I will prove the opposite. And well, here am I, not wearing a suit, nor dress shoes, nor a tie, but still doing modeling. Well, not the kind of modeling that might now come to your mind. I'm talking about computer models. Really, computer models. For generating insights on how we can transform our economy and society to meeting the 1.5 degree target of the Paris Agreement and to make progress towards the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. Okay, now it's getting boring. No, that's in a nutshell what I'm doing at my job at the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research. But how did I get there and all of that without wearing a suit? So when I was 16, I was a computer geek. But I was not a typical gamer. I was rather fascinated by the possibility to use the computer for something meaningful. And once I had convinced my parents in 1997 that I urgently need internet access to do my work for school, I was diving into the back then almost unregulated World Wide Web. And yeah, that opened a whole new world for me. And this world was much broader and more interesting than secondary school in a small-sized city in Bavaria. So the point is that I wanted to use the computer for something useful from early on, but sadly, programming wasn't on the curriculum back then. Instead, we learned many times about World War I, World War II, but never arrived in the past. We hardly touched upon the Berlin Wall and also the German reunification. It almost felt like history is over. But there was one lesson, one of these unimportant lessons towards the end of the school year, like just before the summer break, and this was about fossil fuels and how this is connected to climate change. And this actually triggered my first interest in environmental topics. After finishing secondary school, I moved from Bavaria to Berlin and did a one-year ecological service. This was a break in my life, first of all, because Berlin is really different from Bavaria, and secondly, because I met people that were also interested in environmental topics. It was a great year, and I learned a lot about life and cycling in Berlin, but I had little money. For me, it was clear that the next step in my education should be studying, in the best case, something related to environmental topics. In parallel, I was still very much into computer and programming. And then I learned about the possibility to study and earn money at the same time in a dual study program. That sounded good to me in the first place. That's why I applied for a dual study program in business informatics at Deutsche Bahn, the national railway company of Germany. However, when I realized that I would need to wear a suit at the offices of Deutsche Bahn, well, I guess you know the answer. So I declined the job offer. My parents were not really happy about my decision. They thought that taking the job would have been the better choice for me. But I also have to say they accepted my decision and did not put me under pressure. So eventually I started studying economics at Freie Universität Berlin. And that meant less money, but more freedom, and of course, no suit. So economics at FU Berlin back in 2006 was pretty much neoclassical theory only. That means people act rational, maximize their utility, and have full information. Most of the time, we did manual calculations over several pages, including derivatives and solving equation systems, just to end with a single number, like 5. That was it. Like, no interpretation of the meaning or the consequences of the result. That was very unsatisfactory for me. So why did we do all these calculations when the result is virtually meaningless? Moreover, in neoclassical theory, nature, or in market terms, natural capital, is just a production factor that can be replaced by technology. Frankly speaking, I was very skeptical about that assumption from early on. Therefore, after finishing the bachelor, I left Berlin for a master program in sustainable economics at the University of Kassel. This was another break in my life. First of all, the thinking about nature was very different, because in reality, there are absolute environmental limits that define a safe operating space for humanity. These are the planetary boundaries. Secondly, the people I met in Kassel were very passionate about what they were doing. And yeah, that was very different from Berlin, because yeah, my new student friends were just much more interested in their subject. I really liked that, and some of that passion finally rubbed off. Also, I learned how to use the computer for something useful. I learned to transform environmental problems into equations that can be solved by the computer. That was real fun for me, and I liked it a lot. In my master thesis, I came first in touch with the broad field of land use modeling, which I found very interesting. Luckily, the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research, where I still work today, was looking for a PhD student in the field of land use modeling just when I had finished my master thesis. So I moved back to Berlin. Well, actually, Potsdam at first. But me and Potsdam, that did not really work out. Or to say it in the words of the German indie band Tokotronic, Aber hier leben, nein danke. Sorry, Potsdam. But on Telegraph Hill in Potsdam, I met a great bunch of people working on sustainable solutions for the climate problem. With the help of modeling tools, we developed transformation pathways for different sectors of the economy, such as energy, transport, buildings, and land use. The latter, land use, is my core area of expertise. But depending on the context, I'm also called a peatland expert or an expert for meat substitutes. So how comes? 4 years ago, I got an infographic magazine as Christmas gift that showed two numbers on the title: CO2 emissions from aviation and CO2 emissions from drained peatlands. The drained peatland figure was about double the size of the aviation figure. That was surprising to me, because although working in a group on land use management, peatlands just did not play a role in my work until then. So I started to think about ways how I could include peatlands into our global land use modeling framework. It took a while, but in the end, I had developed a paper with a very clear message that the revetting of drained peatlands is of key importance for climate change mitigation. I was quite confident about the results and thought that it should be relatively easy to publish these in a high-ranking journal, but it was not. I submitted the manuscript to several Nature journals, like including Nature Climate Change, Nature Communications, and Nature Geoscience, but I got desk rejections from all of them. Eventually, my peatland work was published in Environmental Research Letters, which of course is also a respectable journal. The whole process from first idea to publication took about 2.5 years. But in the end, it paid off, because I was invited as a peatland expert at the COP26 Peatland Pavilion in Glasgow last year. This was an opportunity and a challenge at the same time. Admittedly, it was slightly beyond my comfort zone at first, but I took the challenge. Also, this was the first time that I had the feeling that my research is not only excellent, but from a scientific perspective, but also highly relevant for solving the climate problem. In other words, I had the feeling that my research can have a real impact. I had a similar experience just this year when I published a paper on meat substitutes in Nature. This research was triggered by a report about how cultivated meat could disrupt the US livestock sector by 2030. After some research, I decided to focus on microbial protein, which is a meat substitute that is, unlike cultivated meat, available today in supermarkets in the UK and Switzerland. Using our land use modeling framework, I was able to show that if 20% of the global per capita ruminant meat consumption would be replaced with microbial protein, by 2050, global deforestation and related CO2 emissions could be halved compared to a business as usual scenario without such replacements. After several iterations, including a decline from nature and an appeal from my side, the study was finally published in May this year. For my career as a scientist, this was a real game changer because suddenly I got interview requests from international media outlets such as Washington Post, The Guardian, Wired Magazine, and Forbes, while I had never given any interview before spring this year. Again, this was slightly beyond my comfort zone, and I was quite nervous during the first interviews. It took a while, but now I'm also getting more and more interview requests from German TV and radio stations on the topic of meat alternatives and the role of healthy diets for climate change in general. For me as a scientist, this is really nice because the public interest confirms that my work is relevant for solving real-world problems. So, in retrospect, there are three events in my life that shaped my personal and professional development. First, when I studied sustainable economics, I met people with passion for their subject, and some of that passion rubbed off. Second, when I learned to use programming for making projections about the future, that immediately made sense to me, and I liked it a lot. And third, when I started to talk to the media about my work, I learned a lot, and by that, I extended my own comfort zone. And of course, my aversion to wear a suit and dress shoes and a tie was crucial for my career, because if I would have taken the job offered by Deutsche Bahn, the national German railway company, I would not be standing here today as a scientist. So, what does this tell us about life? Don't listen too much to your parents and follow your own path. Thank you.